Okay, good morning, everybody. We're ready for our morning kickoff. We follow the same procedure like yesterday. That is, I make some noise that's irrelevant, and then Leia does the introduction, and then we have Barbara dressing us with her science, and once we are saturated with that, we're gonna hit the coffee. Yeah? So, Leia's hiding now, so I'm not sure if I said something.
Okay.
All right, Leia, take it away.
It's time once again for one of my fabulous introductions. Today we have Barbara Finlay with us. She's from Cornell University. And I will say this about Barbara. She's actually one of the people who really, really, really fit into this meeting, because she does development, she does evolution, and for years and years and years has been interested in the idea of taking principles of development and evolution and building autonomous machines or and those sorts of things. I'll also say she's one of the few people for years and years who've been looking for general rules of brain construction, not just doing comparative studies and not just doing development studies, but digging a little deeper and trying to do that. I also wanted to say, all of us have stewed on Brian's talk, Brian gave a talk yesterday, which was very depressing, that we are basically screwed by our parents' bad decisions even before they decide to have kids. I'm kind of depressed. So this should be a little more uplifting.
Yes. No, she's going. Barbara's going to tell us our brains won't scale. So yeah. They're screwed as well, you know.
The title of her talk is Robust, Plastic, and Scalable Developmental Organization Principles of Vertebrate Brains. Thanks, Barbara.
Okay, great. Okay, well, great to be here, and everybody hear me okay? Yes, this is my real niche from starting at MIT and collaborating with mathematicians and engineers in various ways all my life. So, I should say what I will be doing is in this talk is going through about four or five pretty elaborate projects, a sort of a survey of this kind of thing. So happy to go into more detail at any time, but that's the tack I've been taking here. So so what I'll be talking about is trying to get at, as Lee said, general rules for generating brains. And but before I get into that, I always like to do this first rather than tack it on at the end. So. Not all the collaborators, but my principal ones, I'd like to at least note it's a range of departments here. So this guy's now almost got his MD, but he did a lot of the talk on time translation. Dermot Cahalan from Applied Math and works with also with Steve Strogatz, Christine Charvet, who's a comparative neuroanatomist, my new graduate student, Rudy Aro, who's done a lot of the graphics and the kinds of stuff I'll be extending into right now, which will be motivational systems and things like that. And a lot of longtime colleagues, Roger Reap on more comparative anatomy, my statistics and modeling coworker, my source for Brazilian inspiration and monkey brains, Olaf Sporns on some network stuff that I may or may not get into. So. These are the people that are working reasonably currently on this. So, so when we look at how brains change, we know a couple big things to start with, and I should mention I'll be always talking about vertebrates and typically about mammals. That we know from embryological work and a lot of comparative work that vertebrate brains start from a defined, explicitly defined number of structural elements that are essentially not added or subtracted from, so that you have a set of core segments and core pieces of organization from which to derive all possible brains. Then, if you look at the brain set, you can see that those are virtually unrecognizable as the same thing from one to the next, but they have all these parts, and this particular way of representation in fact, quite minimizes the size differences between these brains, which can go from, this range from a couple of milligrams up to in past rhesus into dolphins and elephants and so forth. But they all have this set of initial elements to begin with. And then presenting this particular set of animals, which are all ones that appear in some of the data sets I'll be talking about, you can see that the obvious behavioral changes, okay, so, and niche changes, so underwater, working in the night or in the dark, lying in the mud or flying through the air, all kinds of things are possible for this particular brain. And so, but I realize as you present a subject this way, this tends to emphasize the elements of the similarity, but particularly the behavioral diversity. And that's really true. So, you know, no matter what you ask a monkey to do, it will never fly, or at least with not significant prosthetics or something. But there's a common set of things that all these animals do, which is, you know, from basic things like move forward with an alternating pattern of muscle construction, to find food and digest it, to find mates, you know, have different kinds of ways of then producing those, but have to in some way either make enough or ensure that organism that they produce survives, all kinds. So there's that sort of basic biology that all of them have to have in common of you know, getting around the world, recognizing what's out there with a pair of eyes and other sensory systems, and then being able to ambulate or to fly or whatever. But there's another thing that they all can do too, or at least their ancestors could, which is to deal with the worst possible catastrophes. So every one of us has ancestors who've been through droughts and horrible changes in temperatures, things that we might be able to look forward to, and meteors hitting the earth and all kinds of things. So we have, so there's not only this ability for adaptation, but the ability to be robust and adaptable in each animal's lifetime to really radically changing conditions. And that has to be brought into account as well when thinking about how brains change. So that's really the problem of evolution and development, Evo Devo. You want to make something that's adaptable enough to change, but robust enough not to die. And how to put those two things together is really the evolution engineering challenge. And we've been filtered by both the need for adaptation and by disaster for both of those things. And that's what I'll be trying to frame up, this sort of quest for looking both for things that are stable and what can change when we look at brain organization. So I'm planning way too much to get through here, but this is best basically three empirical topics and one hope about how to take these three ideas and then produce the necessary adaptability. So I'll be talking about how you first get brain mass in a gross sense funneled into the right sort of computational or behavior adaptational niche. In all cases, I'll try to show you some evidence that the brain, in fact, does vary on that dimension and then show you a developmental mechanism that applies to it. In most cases, in fact, in all cases here, that will be looking at neurogenesis and control of neurogenesis and mentioning other kinds of ways that brain can change. The second, I'll be looking at how you use the kinetics of neurogenesis, and this is just the mathematics of cell division and cell death to get neurons in the right numbers in the right places related to function. This is actually The question I started this whole research energy enterprise with, which is, I was interested in things like, well, the visual system particularly, something that isn't in a single location, that's hard to imagine addressing the visual system as a genetic unit, you know, because you've got to talk about eyes and parts of the brain and motor units and reaching and all those sorts of things as essentially being part of the visual system. If you want to make an animal that's, quote, more visual, unquote, and you want to get all that coordinated, how in the world do you do that? Do you wait for the, you know, 30 to several million simultaneous genetic changes, or do you have coordinating mechanisms, and what are they? And so we're talking about an example of that that we found, and then if we get to it, this last bit. So, okay, so what I want to do first before getting to any of those questions is talk about this, the translating time model that we have that will apply to every one of them. And so first off, shameless plug. So here's a website you all can use should you find yourself in immediate need of you know, that you're, there you are working with your rabbit on the superior colliculus, and you just wish that you knew when the same part of the colliculus was generated in a brush-tailed possum. Okay, so you could do that and take any of the species that are in the model and find out comparable times for brain structures. And that's why we, essentially why we keep it up, and it gets used a lot for that purpose. But basically we've made a model, including of developmental events that I'll be talking about, to find out how do you transmute, or how can first developmental time in making brain, and specifically just brain, be transmuted between animals. So kind of what does happen, or then by extension, what is allowed to happen when an animal extends, the period of its brain production in making a larger brain. How does that happen? You know, how often does that happen? What are the rules in terms of how you extend? And what we're looking at basically is just a giant problem in basic description, which is a rule of mine, which is sort of describe first. So if you describe as many species as possible and how their brain development changes, then you can start to develop rules and you can determine what's common and what's an exception, and how, and a whole lot of things basically in this research that people think are exceptions, particularly since I'm in the psych department, and I'm also a journal editor, the number of times things, sentences in papers and out of people's mouths that begin with something like, the reason humans are unique is, you know, there are a few things that are really unique to humans, but basically nothing that anyone ever says to me is. So we can just really see a lot of our sort of parameters of a really big primate with a big brain, and sort of identifying and having a collection like this allows you to recognize uniqueness when it's really there, as well as commonality. So it's for both things, be able to describe those. First, what's in this model? So the present model is arranged, has 18, but this is a work in progress. We're just about to do a pretty significant update and add in about another 12, a lot of small primates and some really cows and things like that. These are the animals that are generating the present model. They're arranged in generally related groups with animals that are born relatively mature in the middle here, going out radially to animals that are born in relatively immature states, and then a clutch of marsupials that are extremely immature, or about the same as the others, depending on you whether you call birth exit from a uterus or exit from a pouch. And this is one dimension that turns out to really significantly alter aspects of the rate of brain development, at least. But one thing I should point out, this is take what you can get research. This is nothing at all like a, you know, reasonable, decent analysis of phylogenetic variation to get at, you know, the sort of principle. So we're missing, you know, giant groups of animals and ranges of them. We just take what we can get. So things, these are mostly lab animals, not all, but you should expect this model to change, and we are now trying to add selectively animals that would fill in particular questions as opposed to what is just out there to get to assemble. We group our data comes in as events, which is a mechanism in a place in the brain in a species. So location, here's our brain places, so brainstem, cerebellum, cortex, whole organism, whole brain would be things like brain volume overall, or a location, you know, generate Purkinje cells, anything that subsumes those things. A process is a mechanism, like generating a neuron, extending an axon, growing in volume. We include some early behavioral events and electrophysiology. And this diagram is to show that sort of it's the black and red is sort of the evolution of the models. We added things. We began mostly with neurogenesis, been adding more things as we go along, and this is just to show where the distribution of information is. Obviously, a lot about neurogenesis and cortex, and not a whole lot in a few other locations here. Clearly, there's no species in which all these events have been measured. Probably the mouse comes the closest to it, but that laboratory mouse being a weird aberrant animal, not having, and I can prove it, too much to do with regular processes of evolution, that is maybe more of a curse than a blessing in this model. Okay.
Yeah.
I'm just about to explain the time scale. That's okay, what's good. Coming next. So here's what the model is like. All sorts of trial and error, this is a basically regression model. So what we are going to do is take our set of 18 animals with their events, so we know a time for a particular thing, and we are going to force or find the best fit iteratively for the 18, so that each species from the mouse to the monkey, the human, whatever, will have a standard regression equation of this form, where we're trying to predict a Y is a post-conception day, and keep in mind this is important. You have to count from conception and not from birth, since birth varies all over the place with respect to this maturational scale. So we're gonna take for each species and get what the intercept comes down to is essentially onset of neurogenesis in this model. So the intercept is this constant here. A slope times an event scale. Okay, so at the same time that we're forcing a slope and an intercept for maturation, we are forcing an order of all the events. So the reason to do this is you'll have species that are, you know, generating their brains in 20 days versus species that are taking, a good order of magnitude, 20 to 200, to do the same degree of neurogenesis. And we have to figure out some common framework to do that. So what we do is find the best order and interval events, which is an arbitrary scale put on it. Our the one in the model on the translating time work, I think it goes to 12. We're now just usually putting it between 0 and 1. And so here, these things are just sort of standard kinds of events that we have, like this SC segregation is, you know, segregation of contralateral and ipsilateral retinal projections in the superior colliculus. And here, 40% of maximum brain weight is reached, and so forth. And what we've plotted of our 18 animals, we have 5 plotted here. So, and we have real post-conception days, but on a log scale on this axis. So what you could determine from that, if we look at the mouse, is that the mouse is starting to generate its brain at about 9 days post-conception, and then races through all of its possible events that we have here to, let's see, till we get to about 120 days. And the present model ends at about, what is, 3 years post-conception in humans. And we're taking it up to about adolescence and probably won't go further than that. Now, so if you look at the human version of the same thing, first, neurons are appearing about 25 days, but taking much, much longer to get to that terminal thing, about 900 days for the same set of events. Because of the nature of the data, basically, we end up doing rather minimal other adjustments to fit this data. So we have 2 interaction terms, and I'll be describing both of those, which is a set of events that are either described by a location or a process or both that we have to explain. We have to add to the basic regression equation for an animal to make those events fit. So we have 1 for cortex and 1 for retina in nocturnal animals. The cat is one that happened to have both of those. So we see what we're looking at here is the human event and the cortical interaction term, the modeled events both plotted. So this is how we compute sort of the overall tendency across across species to conform to a particular pattern. And where the original surprise was in this to me, which is not what I expected at all, and nobody ever believes me, I remember I was trying to look originally at how you coordinate disparate events across the brain. The way you coordinate them, it looks like, is you never do anything different. The fit of data to model is ridiculous. It's always over 0.99 done this way. So here's just a couple of those things for mouse predicted days versus mouse empirical days, and that's what that sort of fit looks like with those two species. And it's human is actually one of the most variable. But I mean, I think it's mostly because the data is of poor quality, not because humans are intrinsically more valuable. I wasn't saying we're unique. Okay, but this allows us both to get sort of central tendency in this kind of thing and also look for specifically unexpected events. Those are the markers of uniqueness. Those are not errors in the model. That's how we can figure out if there's a likely interesting deviation occurring. What I originally expected was that developmental time was going to be a big source of this coordination, so we should see all kinds of groups of things picking up and varying from one species to the next to make the adaptations we're talking about. And instead, we don't see that at all, particularly for mammals. You get on this developmental train of the brain, and you go forward on it. And we have not been able to convince ourselves yet of anything like, at least in mammals, something like stopping and waiting compared to some other animal and then resuming brain development at some later point. Or you can see that, for example, in the very onset of marsupial neurogenesis, but not in the middle of it. Once you get started, it runs through. There, in cases of metamorphosis, we have things that are definitely in frogs and so forth, tadpoles to frogs, we can see things that are specific changes in things like fish that change their morphology. You can see things of this kind, but in mammals we haven't, and we've looked. So the thing that is really remarkable about it, if you take animals that say do not really differ on that precocial altricial thing, you can take animals that are the same on that particular parameter and overlay brain growth on each other, they will be exactly the same curve. This is something that Passingham noted a long time ago. He just took the weight of the brain at birth for a whole bunch of different animals and found out that you could make a straight allometric growth line. So if you take that as just a brain at n number of days for different animals, you put them up and it will make you a regular line in mammals. You can take bits of things, and this way I just realized for the same, if you put all nocturnal or all diurnal in one patch, you can superimpose eye growth from the very small to a very large eye, so that it's just a matter of when you stop growing, not your manner of growth. So that's one thing that very, very unitary about brain growth. We don't see a whole lot of fooling around and telescoping and compressing of time points within the middle of the growth.
Main point here is that the developmental program is sort of fixed and runs, but it runs at a different speed depending on the species you're dealing with.
Yeah, rate is highly changeable.
Right,
I mean, exactly. That is so rate and duration both, and probably duration is the biggest contributor. We have specific things that change rate, but a limited set. So that's exactly correct. Now, if I did this for body and I've tried, you don't get this. You get a complete distribution of things all over the place because the body growth can go on hiatus and resume again. That's normal plasticity as well as just normal evolutionary differences. So this is something specific in development to the brain.
Is that true if you look at the heart or some other one, organs that are largely formed and then change not as much?
We're right in the middle of that. We were trying to look at, for example, that it's going to be fully formed, but you have the thing of precocial versus altricial animals. So that's something where the heart in an animal is going to have to work independent of its skeletal musculature. And we haven't really got the answer to that, whether you can accelerate that or not. All right, so we're starting this first one, so allocating brain mass strategically. So here's the first thing. This is something that Harry Jarrison noticed a while back, and we're trying to now find a mechanism for and expand it. So across all vertebrates now, there's a persistent pattern emerging of either going in the direction of allocating more mass to olfactory bulb and its attached structures, or basically not privileging them, just going for the rest of the brain or the cortex. So I want to show you what this looks like comparing primates to rodents. What you usually, everyone's seen this picture of the evolution of the brain that shows a rat and then a cat, and then it may throw in some random thing, and then we have a rhesus, and then humans, and some angel or something. Okay, but what that particular diagram confounds are these two factors. So these are two animals with approximately the same brain mass, but one is high on the olfactory limbic component, and one is not. So here we have an owl monkey, and the aotus, and this is an agouti, South American rodent. And so here you can see the large olfactory bulb and the associated olfactory cortex and the neocortex here, whereas in the monkey, all these cerebellum and brainstem parts are pretty much the same, but they're all just sort of physically covered by the ballooning cortex there. So what we're looking at here is we did in two different studies, one with Roger Reap and the other with Kara Yopak, looking at karyopac sharks. So this is a principal components analysis of essentially the same two components. The white bars are the first principal component, and what we're looking at are a set of brain parts that together make up the whole brain. And basically that loads on every part of the brain, the whole brain component, which means that it highly covaries. So the white bars there. Second principal component is the black bars or the gray bars. That's what I'm trying to point out here. The first one is olfactory bulb. And then we have associated olfactory cortex. And hippocampus is in mammals, the largest physical structure in this group that contributes most of the sort of mass to the component. And then we have other things that amygdala and so forth that are associated, but not so much. So basically, in every vertebrate radiation, there is a decision that is made repeatedly to allocate the brain to go in one direction or another with these structures co-varying. Here's work I did with Roger Reap on a set of now just mammals here, and this is now to just highlight this. So we have how limbic, olfactory you are on one axis, and how cortex loaded you are on the other, and the data is dosed up with, as many we can find out, with marine mammals, including the animal that Roger works with, particularly the manatee, and some seals. And what we're interested in this case, is sort of, this is our two principal component, two principal component, one axis, basically, and how do our animals vary on that? And there's a couple things I want to point out. So first off, there's a big negative relationship here. So if you're, that goes overall. So if you have a large iso or neocortex, you're pretty likely to have, at the same time, a low dose of olfactory bulb. So they're negatively correlated in mammals. In sharks, they're not that way. They're just independent. Okay. But also, it turns out that if you look more closely, even within taxonomic groups like insectivores here, it's an old taxonomic group. The taxonomic groups change every year that I do this study, so I can't keep recovering these slides. You can see that there's a negative relationship even within one group like that. So it's not that a whole taxonomic group makes a decision to go one way or another. The set sort of at the time that group diverged, it can change afterwards as well. You can be both or neither. And that's interesting developmentally. So if we have some kind of real zero-sum game, and you can see then, and you can either be high cortex or you can be high olfactory, then the class of developmental mechanisms you're looking at is fewer than if you have an option of being both. And the big carnivores can be both. So you can have both a lot of cortex and a big olfactory bulb. Yeah?
Is this a classical PCA? What's the data that is true?
This isn't a PCA. This is just a ratio.
All right. So when you said the principal components.
Oh, the principal component was the one before.
All right.
So that's when we looked at what covaries of all the structures we have in these different animals. So we found that that all the brain covaries with itself. That's the first principal component. And then olfactory bulb covaries as a second. And the first principal component is 96% of the variance or thereabouts. Right. The second is about 3% of the variance.
And the data is just the sizes of all those structures.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And that's as a proportion of overall brain size.
Yeah, so first off, a whole brain size is the controlling variable, so that makes everything covary.
Yeah.
But it covaries really highly. That's the 96%, which you wouldn't necessarily have to do. We could have a whole bunch of, the somatosensory animals. But at the whole brain level, it's coordinated highly. So then we have this one particular thing that emerges almost certainly independently over and over again in all these different radiations. But what is that going to be. Now, there's one really important thing at this point where if you if I show evidence for one mechanism, that says nothing about whether other mechanisms also are employed for that. In fact, the developmental course I teach, that over the course of scientific life, I've discovered one of the really worst things about the way we set up hypothesis testing is the notion if we show that one thing is true, that means that we're claiming that some other thing is not the case. In development, I had people do the exercise, for example, of tell me all the different ways you can think of mapping array, 1, 2, 3, 4 onto A, B, C, D. And then you can ask, okay, which of these have positive evidence? And so far I haven't had a class that manages to come up with anything that the animal doesn't do. So development is highly mechanistically redundant in that way. Now, one thing that seems really very likely to me, but I have no direct evidence for as yet, is that if you look at the embryo and look at how the tissues we're talking about arranging, here's the dorsal pallium, which gives rise to the cortex in mammals, the medial pallium, hippocampus, lateral, and down here with this amygdala, olfactory cortex, olfactory bulbs, and so forth. And embryonically, it seems to me that what we could do is just give more or less of this tissue to dorsal pallium, and then we get an automatic negative correlation sort of trading relationship. Yeah?
So we talked about the carnivorans.
Yeah.
So why do you think Chiroptera are the other kind of outlier from the trend you spoke of? Do you have any hypotheses on
that? Why functionally?
Yeah.
Well, I'll make up something, but okay, which is what you do in this kind of field, So, think about a tiger or something. They're really, mostly diurnal, highly visual. Well, both actually. So they've got to have a visual system suitable for, dark and night. And also, being carnivores would be really helped out by being able to detect traces of likely prey animals around. So.
But what about the Chiroptera? Why do you think?
Well, they're neither visual nor olfactory.
What? Do you think the resources have been allocated somewhere else?
Their cerebellum isn't that much bigger than it was supposed to be, so it's just they're just kind of evenly balanced on the two, and not unusually large. There's two groups in here, which we didn't distinguish here, but there's sort of the small brown bat kind and the fruit bat kind. So that's there versus there. And one thing, the reason why we're interested in these guys were that most marine mammals have essentially lost their olfactory bulbs, because if you breathe underwater, you tend to drown if you're a mammal. And so you kind of give up on that. So these are different from the monkey version. They're kind of more like, evolutionary lesion experiments, where that's been taken out. We tried to see, so you get more, but basically what we found is while you get a big effect on olfactory bulb and olfactory cortex, it's still pulling the hippocampus in, which doesn't really get a whole lot of direct olfactory projections. So one mechanism you could imagine for having a smaller olfactory bulb is to make it and kill it, and then kill everything attached to it, and that doesn't account for it. Okay, so we're still finding co-varying things that aren't directly innervated by olfactory bulb here. There's just a whole bunch of interesting stuff in here for inference. But so here's one possibility, and I just mostly wanted to put this up there as an example of things that I'm probably sure do contribute in terms of allocation, but that's not what I have the means to study. What I do have is time. So this is our first principle. This is the first interaction term here. So in the case of everything in this data set but our rodents and our one rabbit, you must delay cortical neurogenesis by the amount shown there compared to the rest of the brain to make it fit the general model.
Right. Delay the time in which it occurs or delay the onset?
Everything about it. Mm-hmm. So all these things are, start layer 6, end layer 6, start layer 5. So these are a whole bunch of things to do with cortical neurogenesis, every one of them that is a date here. So you see that. So here's how we model it in macaque, in humans, in the cat. And then here's the interesting one, in the marsupials as well. In fact, it's so striking that it's everything but rodents. If you go back and do the analysis, it really looks like that the derived form is rodents, that the base form is probably more in mammals. The one with the regular sized cortex, which is sort of peculiar, at least in terms of giving a parsimonious account of the data we have. Does that make sense? You see what I mean? So if we produce a model that requires that we change the duration of something in 90% of the animals, and then we ask, okay, so which is more likely in that we change 90% of them or change 10% of them? Probably the change 10%, but we can't really distinguish that in this kind of model. This is not a phylogenetic study. Yeah.
So the rodents, are you talking about mice and rats, or are there squirrels in there?
We have mice, so mouse, rat, guinea pig, hamster, spiny mouse, and the marsh. That's it. No squirrels.
I think if you threw a squirrel in there, that would might be different.
Yeah, I would love to have a squirrel. There's so little developmental stuff.
Yeah.
So, and this is the sort of thing that that these generalities from this set of animals can always can change.
I'm a bit confused now because the earlier plot showed some sort of modular, development or evolution of the brain of these different species. It's very clustered. Right.
Which
on the previous plot, right? So, and I
thought it's not. It's clustered, but it's certainly continuous. Okay, I mean, this is kind of the whole brain versus the collection of 5 limbic structures. So, modular is a funny way to describe that. It's more like allocation of resources.
But also to describe it as a continuum would be equally strange because it's still very different. Right, and they're clearly clustered. So they would argue, okay, if I'm going to design such a species, then which parameters am I controlling? Right, this is the question that we're dealing with.
Mm-hmm.
So, but the thing that stands out would be the clustering.
The clustering. Yeah, that really is. I mean, so it's clear that this whole group of animals is, anteaters and insectivore. These are all factorally dominant. So if you look at primates, more visual, and some of these animals that the olfactory component change in this is so minor that I'm thinking it might be a difference between cortex and hippocampus, like one of the primates are longevity specialists. Mm-hmm. It might be something different than a sensory.
The cortex and hippocampus are also tightly coupled, right? You cannot really.
Well, they're coupled, but the cortex is specifically in long-term storage, whereas the length of the day never changes. So, we get animals that are living for 2 or 3 months as opposed to 70, 80 years, and that may require a different kind of brain.
Right. So what I was not getting, so here, what speaks here for me is this idea of clustering, okay, for you, continuity. And in the next slide, you're saying that one of the key controlling parameters that you now are identifying is sort of the onset of cortical development.
Yeah, so we take.
And that's a bit I didn't get.
So we're going to look at what we're looking at here, and we don't have the ability to discriminate just how much cortex is a continuous variable in this thing. But so here's, in here is the rhesus macaque with relatively more cortex. Here's a cat with cortex and olfactory bulb, and down here in rodents somewhere we have the opposite. And so the question is, what developmental mechanism could we address to get more cortex or less olfactory bulb, I suggested one policy we have didn't look at is initial allocation. But this says in that one example of a primate, in that one example of a cat, so forth, what we have evidence for is in those animals, the onset of generating cortex is delayed. So we're looking at now, you know, in this case, five individual animals that are just parts of that scatter plot, which has, you know, 100 or more animals in it, okay? So in those animals that we have that have relatively more cortex, we also find that they delay their cortical neurogenesis, okay? They could also be doing other stuff.
Right.
Or,
okay.
So, and I don't know whether they're delaying it or whether the others are accelerating it. Both are possible. We can't distinguish that in this kind of data, in these kind of data. Okay. So I showed you allometry, and now I've shown you. This is a correlation, but it's evidence for a real mechanism that the pattern of development, in fact, in these animals is different and in this particular way. All right. Okay, now just briefly here, sort of as an aside, going into a sort of smaller scale, moving to lesser scales than half the brain, or a third of the brain. Why does delay, I didn't really say, why does delay of neurogenesis make something be larger? Because neurogenesis is the start of the end of the generation of the precursor pool. So the more you delay more neurogenesis, the more stem cells you have, the bigger the structure will be. Okay, that doesn't end at a, it's not that you stop, suddenly stop making stem cells and you suddenly begin making neurons. One tails off and the other starts up, but that essentially the beginning of neurogenesis tells you that that process has begun. So to make something later makes it larger in terms of counting cells and then everything else that follows from that. So we've really looked for this, and we're looking for, you know, can we find this elsewhere? I'm sure we're going to find it someplace, but we haven't really yet. So animals, you know, there are visual animals and non-visual animals. We were interested looking at some monkeys and things we had. Do we, you know, is the size of primary visual cortex bigger in animals that are diurnal, and is that related to changes in neurogenesis? We've had a hard time showing much of effect of niche in these bigger animals, so it's on primary visual cortex. So looking at nocturnal and diurnal species, they pretty much, looking at the size of primary visual cortex versus the rest of cortex, they overlap. And given that, we can't find, you know, evidence for how to make it bigger if we can't show that it's bigger in the first place by this way. And so we've kind of looked all over the data set trying to find different conjunctions of things that might be sort of niche specific changes in neurogenesis and haven't found any yet. Not that we never will, but that brings up an issue that's really, I think, extremely important in this case, which is there are a whole lot of other mechanisms that do just that, but we haven't been able to find neurogenesis contributing to it. This is how I started my scientific life, looking at exuberant early connections and neuron loss as part of putting structures together. So one thing that is definitely true in the cortex, if you look at, given the kinetics of neurogenesis, how many neurons would you expect to find in each bit of the cortex, and I'll explain this a bit later. What you find is there are extra neurons in primary areas, and work that I'd done years ago suggested that the amount of early thalamic input to a cortical region can push up or down the amount of cell of normal neuron loss in that area. So we have a way of modifying neuron numbers up due to the amount of input. Other research shows that mostly by doing some of this, Leah's Leah's done and Pashka Rakesh and others, that increasing and decreasing the amount of thalamic input will change the range of cortex that's devoted to a particular modality. And then there's any number of demonstrations that changing the amount of activity in an area will can change the volume of that area, starting from the number of synapses to the things that are supporting the synapses to the number of dendrites supporting the synapses and so forth and the connections between them. So what I'm starting to see this now as neurogenesis scaffold and this whole suite of mechanisms as the things that tune a particular brain to a particular niche, and that these are all can produce a fair amount of, you know, a good deal of difference from one structure to the next, but they're generic. They don't have anything to do with a visual animal only in its V1 has more plasticity. All animals have more plasticity. This, however, generating more neurons from there is a genetic kind of change.
But which of these are all these three mm-hmm. equally controlled by specific, let's say, critical periods?
No, not at all. So I don't know, have people been following the stuff on echolocation in blind humans recently, for example?
A little bit, yeah. It's fascinating.
Yeah, so a bunch of research of that, the one I've been talking to, Mel Goodale, has been... So some humans who are blind from birth figure out that they can echolocate, and they start making clicks and hearing the responses back, and they experience it as vision, sort of. Mm-hmm. Can do things as fast as riding bicycles, and now Mel Goodale and others are showing that the area of the brain that you use for that is in fact primary visual cortex in others. Mm-hmm. So you take this real underserved area in a congenitally blind person, and it gets repurposed. But that's been shown before, and that was shown with a whole bunch of studies on braille reading. Same groups. They started with congenitally blind people, found out that they would allocate braille reading also into V1. And then they kept sort of, this gets at your question, then we keep dragging it in better and closer. And then so turns out you only have to close your eyes 2 weeks and try to learn braille to start using your primary visual cortex for braille. Mm-hmm. So,
right. Yeah. So, I'm thinking here because the three mechanisms you list, mm-hmm. if you think about, for instance, a more activity dependent mm-hmm. change in volume, sounds like mm-hmm. a rather non-specific mechanism.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
While maybe, let's say, apoptosis might be more mm-hmm. specifically controlled.
Yeah, I mean, it could be that this is amplified in primary sensory areas because the primary sensory areas are different. There's a lot of genetic stuff going on in this. That's quite possible. I guess my point is not that I have demonstrated that this is. The one thing I found just really interesting is I started by asking questions of people who believe that human language required specific genetic changes. Okay, so tell me one, I would say. Okay, what is that that I should look for as an anatomist? But you can make that broader. Tell me one thing that's visual about primary visual cortex. Mm. Okay? There's an answer to that question that you could come up with is that there's a sort of time of, temporal onset of visual information that you want to have a particular neurotransmitter, or maybe a length of axon would be kind of optimal for the sort of statistical structure of the visual field or any number of things. Not one example, to my knowledge, of anything like that.
And this mm-hmm. is really cool because maybe the genetic changes, and it's always been a question mm-hmm. of how do you match the body with the brain?
Mm-hmm.
How do they co-evolve? Maybe the genetic changes are coming to the morphology, the body
yeah.
plan.
Yeah, so
specialized
yeah.
receptors in the eye or the hands or the mm-hmm. tongue mm-hmm. or the vocal tract. Mm-hmm. And what's leading what? And if there's always the assumption that you plop this brain in there and mm-hmm. then you got it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, I started from the position of brain first given by, and I've been sort of pushed to the other side that the source of plasticity is the periphery, mm-hmm. both motor and sensory, and you have a generic structure that's willing to really, throw everything it has at determining the structure of that periphery. All right, so this is, now topic two, we're okay with this allocation thing. So this is changing. So I showed you one case where I know that the pattern of neurogenesis is changed. And then I showed you one case where I can't find any evidence that it has been changed yet. And now I'm going to talk about the specific problem of scaling of nervous systems to different sizes. Now I'm kind of going to blow this off really fast here, but this, what I want to talk about is just the overall context of scaling in the brain to begin with, and a developmental correlation. Okay, so if you take the sort of laid out neural plate and its principal axes of medial to lateral, anterior to posterior, you can use all this elegant work that people have done to determine fate maps for the locations along here. So I'm taking this approximate region of the neural plate and putting a fate map of that same region sort of unrolled for the chick that these guys have described, and this is generally in Lewis Ploss's general framework. And so what you find is that each location, as you go from medial to lateral, produces a particular kind of neuron. So we have motor neurons or secondary visceral motor neurons, and then going out through sensory neurons, and then organizational sensory regions, where we just cut off right here, but we go through the same motor sensory and then add cerebellum at this edge here. And then the same thing, you get the same thing and kinds of segmentation that people argue about for the forebrain as well. But basically, location, you know, severely constrains or exactly specifies the type of cells that's going to give rise to in the adult brain, and then they're going to migrate away, so you have to find out where they originally from. But this original map is also a, if you midline here to midline here, is a rough map of duration of neurogenesis as well. So the closer you are to the midline, the shorter the period of neurogenesis is, and that's so you don't proliferate motor neurons very much, if at all, as brains get larger, but the parts of brain that do have a longer and longer time to proliferate are the ones sitting on the lateral border. What are those? In the limit, that's cerebellum in the midbrain, and that's the pallial structures, olfactory cortex, neocortex or isocortex, and hippocampus up in the forebrain, all sitting right next to each other on the very most lateral edge. But then the big nuclear masses, basal ganglia, midbrain, and so forth, are also relatively larger. So if you do these averages, you see that overall in different brains you get longer durations on the lateral edge, and given this sort of big bump for the cerebellum, also more as you go towards the anterior border, and that. We're arguing is the basic thing that makes the cortex, in these cases, go from occupying about 20% of the total volume of the brain to 80 or 90%. And so the late neurogenesis equals a relatively larger structure, and that comes down to being a feature of being in a lateral location in the brain. The one thing that's interesting about this is that when people think about evolving functions, you tend to think of, okay, so I would like to be a really good navigator, so how am I going to change that part of the brain to do it? Well, if being a really good navigator is being really good at taking snapshots of things you're navigating through, for example, you might move your navigation space to the part of the brain that has the resources to do that, the hippocampus sitting there with a whole lot of cells. You wouldn't necessarily, the order of let me think of the function and let me adapt the kinetics of neurogenesis to it may be backwards. And that's, in fact, that is the order of things in embryology. First you set the duration of neurogenesis, and then after cells have left the precursor pool in time, then they become specified for function. So it could be that you that functions have moved into places where the timing is advantageous. And as the brains get big, they specifically make a generic thing that they do not decide that the really great thing to do would be to really balloon out the number of motor neurons, but rather to generate more of these polysensory multimodal regions. Yeah. So that's overall. Okay, so now for cortex, instead of just general, we decided to get really specific. And so this is the second thing about gradients in neurogenesis, about how the significance of a particular gradient of neurogenesis within the cortex for its structure and its function. In this case, we're talking about not just, look, this is really big and this is really long, but we're talking about setting up the equations to generate the exact number of layers, the exact number of cells in different cortical layers across species. So we had to get some numbers for this, which are distributed in all sorts of ways across the literature, but we, Christine Charvet and Dermot together did actually count up stereologically for three different New World monkeys and two New World rodents and the hamster, which happened to be around. So we got, for all these guys, everything is represented here at once. This is the total number of cells in the cortex, going from this hefty number in the capuchin monkey, the cebus, and I'm sure you can see the total number of neurons here in the hamster on the same scale. Okay, this is cortical area, is the circle. And then what these represent are the number of neurons per column of cortex from front to back in the cortex for all these different, and what they show is, here we have put them all in the same slide, that as you go have a larger cortex, the more less flat, I guess, the more steep the difference is in the number of neurons from the back to the front of the brain per cortical column. I'll describe what I mean by that in a lot more detail. So if we look across the agouti or the hamster cortex, we find that the number of neurons per column in both the upper and the lower layers doesn't change very much as you go from the front to the back of the cortex. But in our biggest animal here, we find that as you go from front to the back, you get a significant slope across there. And that second, all of that effect is coming from the upper layer neurons in the cortex. If people aren't familiar with cortex, just hold on there. I will get to showing you what I mean by that. Okay, now, here's a bigger brain still. This is stuff with Christine Collins. And so this is a baboon cortex. This is the back, this is primary visual cortex here, up in front, frontal cortex. And as you get to a bigger brain still, we plotted here density, but I could do number because they basically produce the identical graph. The number of neurons per column increases in that fashion. And I think you can see here is that little bump I mentioned earlier for being in a primary area is there. So that's probably the cell death effect. Now, okay, so one thing to point out, this is not talking about the whole forebrain. This is a gradient that is restricted just to isocortex. This is a gradient that people have known about for ages from the very first studies that were ever done in neurogenesis or even gross morphology. So this is when the brain starts out. It's a coronal section in rat or monkey, front of the cortex, back of the cortex, and you can see that the front of the cortex gets started earlier and the back a bit later. It's quite obvious in both cases. The difference in starting out is small, it's about a couple of days. The difference in when you end is a whole lot. So by the time you get to the caudal pole, the caudal pole, the cortex in a monkey, will be going for at least 3 weeks more after the frontal pole has shut down completely. And so that's another late equals large thing. So the longer you go, the more precursors, the more cortex you have. And this gets a little bit hairy trying to describe. Just there's two kinds of location you can be. You can be in a layer, or you can produce cortical area. So we've been looking at the mechanisms that produce a whole cortical column. And so, as has been described many times, Rakesh and a number of other individuals, that the neurons are generated in the ventricular zone, and they migrate up to the cortical plate. At that point, they get out in inside-out order for the most part, except for modulatory or inhibitory neurons. And then they form a layered inside-out structure and eventually end up producing both these columns of cortex and the repeated unit of a column over this whole area of cortex. And the interesting thing is sort of the relationship between the two. How do we make this increasing area and these columns appear at the same time? And so it turns out that they're not as uniform as you're always taught in a couple of different ways. So what Dearman has been doing is making a model, and this is basically multiple ordinary differential equations, but instead of just modeling one at a time, you use these things, computers that I've heard about, that you model them all at once. Okay, so we've looked at the period of generation for neurons, the periods in where when they stop doing that, cell death, and a whole number of different things to try to do the title of this paper here. It's modeling local and cross-species variation in the cortex is arising from a common mechanism. So we want to describe things that change the cortex as you go from front to back in the same way that you describe differences between species in one single group of equations. So we're looking at the effect of the size of the progenitor pool, when we generate those neurons, how fast we quit generating neurons, all the different parameters of neurogenesis or cytogenesis in general, and fit a number of those all at once. And what we do is make them fit the sort of patchy empirical data that we have. So we know the number of neurons in the progenitor pool over a bunch of species. We know the amplification of the number of whole neurons in the cortex. And we also know across the cortex how many neurons are generated for the upper layers or the lower layers. So we try to fit all those adult cross-species parameters with these at once. And you can do that. And so so our current best fit model is the one I led off with here, which is putting development and species differences together. So if we start out with a cortex that basically starts itself by a small cortex that starts by generating from the front and then going onto the back and then contributing more and more, what you first get is in this mouse producing its cortex from embryonic day 13 to 21, it produces sort of equal numbers of the red and the blue, that's the upper cortical layers and the lower cortical layers. And then we go to a ferret-sized animal and let it go for considerably more time, and then the effect of our gradient begins to emerge, where this cuts out early. We have roughly equal amounts in the frontal cortex, but the posterior visual cortex continues to proliferate, so now we have many more neurons per column in posterior cortex, and that's what we're looking at here for a brain of intermediate size. And finally, we take a rhesus, and this animal has a great deal of extra time to continue generating primary visual cortex, and we have, again, roughly equal upper and lower layer numbers in the frontal cortex and very few layers per neurons per cortical column and many, many more in the back. I've used this before at one other meeting. I think it was at that one as well. But there are a bunch of correlations in the world that may not mean anything at all, or maybe they're extremely significant. Okay, so maybe, so the fact that the moon exactly matches the angular dimensions of the sun, and so we can have an eclipse. Okay, now this probably doesn't mean a damn thing, but all of it could be divine intervention or something. but in the case of the cortex, what happens is that people thought that the cortex was uniform for the longest time because there's many more connections and neuromass in the frontal cortex compared to the back of the cortex, which has so many cells, and those things cancel out, so the cortex is the same thickness everywhere, but it doesn't have the same composition everywhere. Now this is, I'm gonna argue that this actually means something, okay, that it's not like the sun and the moon.
The Barbara question mm-hmm. here about, mm-hmm. so you have two gradients in this case to explain this progression mm-hmm. of brains.
Mm-hmm.
So the neurogenesis one, I think is clear, because mm-hmm. that's basically your timer, which you're just spitting out your
mm-hmm.
neurons.
Mm-hmm.
But the scaling gradient, I don't really understand. How should I interpret that?
In the next slide.
Okay. I'm psychic, you
see. Yes, okay. So why is the composition of a cortical layer changing? And that's, what we're interpreting that is this. Here, so when you're going to specify a cell in the nervous system, when you're going to make a cell in the nervous system, you have two things. First, you have to exit the precursor pool, and then after that, somewhat influenced by your division history, but mostly influenced by what happened then by the environment you are generated into, you become the particular cell. Okay, so. What we think is happening here is that the neurogenesis envelope is changing, but the specification timing thing is not. So that when the primate cells are exiting to be specified, they are hitting at the time when layer 2-3 cells are being instructed, and so that's why we're getting all of these extra 2 and 3 cells and not just the same cortical thing being reproduced at different sizes. That's how our model accounts for the data, and I'm just going to talk about a case in the retina that looks the same way. Mm-hmm. That we can move slide these schedules with respect to each other. So we end up with a cortical column that's about twice as high, or more, 2 to 3 times as high in bigger brains, and differently composed. Now there's a whole lot of other kind of interesting stuff that I haven't done, that other people have done. There's a set of like 11 papers by Markov and Henry Kennedy and David Van Essen and so forth, sort of doing, you know, the Van Essen diagram? That's that sort of pastel picture of things connected to everything.
We saw it yesterday.
Yeah, so you use it in anatomy classes to really scare people. You have to memorize this, you say. Okay, But they've that was a really kind of a bad data set, even though it's been analyzed a lot, because I know, because I even went to look. People were interested in visual system stuff, and they literally threw out the rest of the brain, so you didn't know where all the cells projected to if you talked about the whole brain. So they did that whole thing all over again for every area of the brain, and produced a number of studies of connectional anatomy, about what's connected to what for. You know, this is real anatomy that now can be sort of registered with DTI and everything. So so here's something, as you go from essentially from frontal to occipital cortex, and this is just Markov's and all accounting, how many different other areas of cortex project to that area. So what you have is the frontal areas with the fewer cells is getting all this connection sort of converging on it from all over the cortex. And primary visual cortex has the least convergence at all, and it's sort of the reverse. It's sending out the most connections from all those neurons. And the one thing interesting, the motor cortex is different from everything else, which it should be, but that's another story. Okay. You look at network metrics, you get the same kind of thing, where the big hubs and networks, they're in the cell sparse regions in frontal cortex, or the sort of head ends, the sparsest ends of the other ones. If you look across the cortex, here's our sort of schematic of how that looks. So here we have an occipital cortex. You get these densely packed small cells, lots of pixels, I like to think about it, whereas in anterior cortex, very big cells, lots of dendrites, lots of synapses, much convergence, motor cortex sitting about here. And, you know, so this is the cortex. This is what is, you know, a lot of analysis being done here. And I think that this, and this is a, you know, mildly past the data hypothesis, but that's what we're here for, right? Okay. So here we have a developmental gradient that almost certainly started off in animals that had no illusions of eventually studying themselves and putting little chunks of their own brains on slides and stuff like that. But as you get bigger, you get brains that have this feature of progressively reducing dimensionality. So you're crunching, you know, millions of neurons into fewer and fewer as you go from back to front in the brain. And the connections are polarized that way. We have a paper on that by a new student in TINS last year about this particular hypothesis and how that comes under. And then if you think about the brain as a predictive organism, as a predictive entity as well, that means that as predictions about the consequences of actions and so forth and memory and whatever are going back in the brain, we're bringing perceptual motor decisions under increasingly abstract control. So it works both ways. And there's a really nice study that came out in 2014 showing that your ability to do things involving sort of hierarchical reinforcement learning or suppress, you know, competing responses is something that really across taxonomic groups depends on the size of the brain. So, remains to be investigated, but I think this is something that has a sort of functional correlate that just jumps out at you. That you, what do you want? If you have the energetic resources to make a bigger brain, where to best invest it? Invest it in a progressive hierarchy, this says.
But what would be the anatomical signature of that, these two different modes of learning?
I took that from the literature, from work of Bob Frank and others. So occipital cortex basically sort of chugs along doing, constant correlational learning. But the major output of the motor cortex and frontal cortex is through the basal ganglia and straight into that whole reinforcement circuitry. Mm-hmm. So we get sort of like two different chunks of brain here that are acting in different ways with regard to learning principles. So statistical learning occurs here as well, but we add the reinforcement feature to these motor actions for that chunk.
Right. I was thinking maybe you have in mind, let's say, gradients also of neuromodulators that are sort of not distributed equally in these different systems.
Yeah, I never thought of that before. That's really interesting. So it's
dopamine, for instance.
It is front tailing off to back.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And then dopamine is also often seen as mediating,
right,
let's say, reinforcement type signal.
Yeah, I'll put that in.
Good.
Okay. good. Yeah. All right. So, we think so much about, you know, adaptation specific things, but let's go back to our, you know, world of catastrophe here. If you're one of those, you know, mammals trying to deal in, you know, after Jurassic Park land or something like that, you need some sort of hierarchical reinforcement learning thing that you can apply to any old damn thing that comes along, not what you were just immediately adapted to. And so you think about, you know, learning both in the species-specific maximally adapted niche, but also sort of when all hell breaks loose, we got to think of both of those things at once. Okay, so one last, am I too much here? Is that okay?
Okay. Well, look, let's see where we are.
Okay.
How many slides? How many more slides?
Just a couple. Just this last one about the retina.
Okay, cool.
Okay. So I showed you this thing here, which is, you know, change the envelope of neurogenesis. We have three types of cells. We have a specification clock that's going on unaffected by this. And so for cortex, we change neurogenesis, and we have this disposition of numbers of cells, but then this other animal, because these two clocks, only one of the clocks has shifted. We have really some direct evidence that this has, in fact, occurred in the nocturnal retina for a different kind of problem. So this is our north of Brazil work with Luis Carlos, and so we've been elaborately characterizing the details of the visual system of these two animals. He does electrophysiology, I do a lot of counting stuff. And so these animals are an interesting pair. So all anthropoid monkeys are diurnal, you know, daytime vision specialists, but one, which is the owl monkey here, and there are various species of aotus, and those are have been evolved relatively recently as these things go. And but they evolve into a full suite of nocturnal features. The only one that's missing is that reflective thing called the tapetum, which bounces things back out of the eye. So if you look at their retinas, you find in the owl monkey, you find many, many more rods. And so here, these curves here are drawn to the scale of what we find. So there's many more rods tiling the very, very much larger for body size retina. So you can't really see it here, but that the aotus eye is gigantic with respect to the head size compared to Cebus there. And you have more rod bipolars, which those connect to. You have slightly fewer ganglion cells and cones, and sort of independent of that, one whole photopigment is missing. The retina is reconformed, so instead of having a high central specialization of fovea and a foveal pit, the aotus doesn't have that anymore. And I didn't list all the cells in the retina because we just haven't counted them all, but I assume that every single cell type in the retina is changed in these guys. Now, one possibility for how to change this retina is to make new genetic instructions for, you know, make, you know, 80% rods and 20% this, and we're going to change them all in other animals. But if you look at how the neurons are generated in the retina, something leaps out at you, which is diurnal first, nocturnal last. So the retinal ganglion cells are and cones and the horizontal cells attached to them are generated first, and then later the rod bipolars and the rods. And we already know, when I talked about the cortex stuff, that we have two things. One is make the precursor, pull an exit from it, and then get specified. Okay, so what we could do here is assume that this is the basic stem diurnal pattern. We know that is the stem in these animals, and we know exactly how many cells are produced and so forth. And all we gotta do is change we don't wanna lose the ganglion cells, the cells are projected in the brain, but we just wanna change the envelope so that we are producing more cells during the time when rod specified. So we want to say that the cell cycle is changed. The cell cycle exit is altered in this way in aotus. So we looked at embryos of aotus and Cebus down in Brazil. And that's exactly what you see. So we hypothesized that aotus is going to delay its cell cycle and so forth, so that we find that aotus has more cells cycling for a much longer time. Things that are associated, so we looked at the actual uptake of DNA stuff, we looked at the genes associated with continuing the cell cycle, things associated with stopping the cell cycle, and everything converges to show that in the aotus, the cell cycle in the retina exit is delayed, and then number of cells in the high points is produced for a longer time. So that's what this takes, you know, how are you going to count them, say 12 to 13 separate cell steps, and turn them into one switch that we can just sort of change this rheostat and by moving it along, get a change in the whole complement of cells that are functionally organized. Now, those of you who are not hardcore theists should be jumping up at this point. Okay, so why are the cells sitting there in an order that permits their future modification conveniently and handily from one side to the other? This is something that you'd really, that is not part of the usual kind of explanation. I think it's the filter hypothesis again. So we are the descendants of creatures who, considering from the dawn of vertebrate time, have gone from light to dark to light to dark. And so the ones who have made that switch successfully, presumably, are the ones that had that to begin with. In support of that, if you look at a lot of fish retina and so forth, you don't find this particular order. It's a different one. Those animals would not have been through this set of changes in their stems. Also, this is our second interaction term. So in a cat and the rabbit, if we take out the interaction term and just plot predicted versus expected for all of our cat neurogenesis days, and then we take everything associated with rods in the retina, everything in the cat is longer than we predicted that have to do with rods. So this is, the cat is doing the exact same thing as the owl monkey, essentially just measured in a different way. It's now privileging and producing more of all the late generated cells in the retina and making those things wholesale go longer. And we catch some of the diurnal group too. So we have to go back and maybe get and look into details of the original reports of this stuff. So this is the evolvability notion. So we have to think about the history of life on Earth to look at what is a repeatedly encountered kind of challenge. What are we likely to have mechanisms for in us because our ancestors made it through those things? Okay, so let this.
Now, are these, in the case of the retina evolution, are these also more strongly predicated on environmental factors? Or once they're stacked up like this in time, they are still executing a standard program.
Executing a standard program.
Okay, so that's not the
fact. Yeah, because I really started out making the wrong guess with this, and that's how I got sort of schooled on the thing. So I, if you know about deprivational myopia, so you can, one way of making your eye bigger is to be an academic like you all. Okay, and so if when your eyes are, starting out, if they're defocused, which is what everything but your phobia is when you're trying to read as a scholarly little child. And so that will, teleologically, your eye checks its growth. No, this is the case. Your eye checks its growth when it's getting a high acuity signal out of it. Mm-hmm. Okay, so. If it doesn't, it seems to make the assumption, this is the teleological part, that it needs to grow some more, okay, and that will make you myopic. It will make your eyes too long for the power of your optics. So I thought, so we're taking this cone out of these owl monkeys. I know a way I could make those eyes bigger. I'll harness the myopia part, so we'll start them off, and we're going to change that eye growth pattern. And they'll be the same, but then they'll fail to get this high acuity signal from the cones, and then they're going to keep getting bigger and bigger. Nah, not at all. They started out at a higher rate from the very beginning, and there's no change associated with myopia thing. So so both the neurons and the eye growth seems to act as if it's a
organ. So we won't get these monkeys to read anytime soon.
No.
Okay.
So yeah, I think that's about their cortex actually. But, so. Okay, so this is just to sum up then. So the last point is just And we start with this conserved components. I just mentioned this sort of monolithic single factor growth stuff across species. Oops, got that. Then we see scaling that not only just makes the grain bigger, but changes its organization as it gets bigger as well. We have some parameter setting things. We started out with one about a nocturnal, diurnal, or maybe a cognitive difference for allocated olfactory and so forth, but we also have this more cellular-based one for nocturnal and diurnal eyes that you can set for, that you have there to exploit, I guess, for commonly encountered niche changes. And this is always added too much as an addendum, I think, where, you know, then we got regular brain and then we have plasticity. Plasticity is the brain. So adjusting this scaffold to the periphery is the mechanism of seeing what's out there, getting a statistical structure, you know, allocating brain number of neurons to part according to what is active is how we take this generic structure and make it adaptive to particular things. The thing I think is the most interesting that I've switched over to working on a lot right now is engineers in general, the ones I work with over the years, do not appreciate motivation, or at least only one kind, often. Okay. And so what where all the churning, you know, think about the cortex getting big, but where things are really churning across species is that base of the brain about, you know, do you make a long-term commitment to just one mate? Do you hate being in crowds? Do you want to, you know, defend a territory of a million miles or 2 inches? You know, there's all those kinds of things that depend on what kind of niche you're in, that depend on a really pretty sophisticated analysis of what you're like and are changing in this basic way from one set of animals to another, and they're going to change what kind of information you get, the importance you give to it, and how you populate your brain. So I think understanding sort of sensory plasticity, but in the context of motor, the concept of these big, important, organizing motivational changes is the way to understand how brains evolve, and that's what's next. So thanks, that's it.
Mm-hmm. All right, it's question time, and Tony will chair us if he can escape from his chair. Brian. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I'm struck by the similarity in your story to the story that Pandya used to tell about the two moieties. Am I correct that you're saying the same thing?
That
Deepak Pandya used to talk about the two moieties in development, one being olfactory hippocampal, the other being cortical.
That division turns up ceaselessly. So I think Jerison is the first on that. But then there's other. And quite a lot of the time when people are talking about what they call mosaic changes in the brain, you know, sort of piece by piece interaction, they're just looking at one piece of those two big strategic changes. So it shows up as not only this sort of whole organism thing, but also as people's candidates for a look at this specific adaptation quite often. So I really don't know exactly the precise intellectual history of when this comes up, but it's so pervasive that it does come up quite a bit.
Questions?
So I had a question about this story, particularly with regard to the evolution of nocturnality and, mm-hmm. and this suggestion that there is this program for developing nocturnality, which is latent, I guess, mm-hmm. is what you would have to say.
It's almost overt. I mean, it is. It's the periphery of the retina.
So what would be? Yeah. How would you test that hypothesis? I mean, that there's a latent. I mean, you mentioned it's not there in reptiles. Is there some other tests?
Yeah. So it should make a bunch of of predictions of the kind you do in this, where you are often prohibited from real experiments, but that the more transitions of this kind, the descendants or the ancestors of an animal have gone, the more organized this order should be. If I do this experimentally, if I'm going to delay the neurogenesis, I should get the pattern that I claim.
Yeah, I was wondering if that's maybe some experimental manipulation.
So if I just all delay. In fact, I've had this experiment in my head, which is sort of a Frankenstein experiment, for the longest time. Can't get anyone to do it, but we've got primates. We are making that switch early on to more cortex, less olfactory bulb. The interesting thing about that is, you look at the olfactory bulb components; they are quite distributed. It looks like a signal. In monkeys, in this, the work that Pashkar Rakesh did on neurogenesis, all those olfactory things go and determine neurogenesis on the same day. I thought it was a big mistake that he made, but it's not. And so that means if there's a general signal that goes out that turns off, cytogenesis and all your olfactory structures, you could turn it back off again, and we could make a big olfactory monkey. So there's kind of experiments like that that you could do. But a lot of it is just, Stephen Jay Gould talked about this, how you do experiments in an evolutionary context. You just have to go back and forth and back and forth between data you have and the data you predict. And,
So if you look at these developmental programs, in some sense, we always are analyzing that from the perspective, like there's, let's say, this prototypical example of a species that everything is converging to. Mm-hmm. But in some sense, you could argue that you also want to maintain and you want to assure variability within that group, right? So and also now in your analysis, we look very much at, what are the stereotype patterns we expect from the brain to emerge?
Yeah.
But how do we also still, from this developmental perspective, guarantee variability across those stereotype patterns?
Yeah, that's a really, to tell you the truth, I was actually driven from that by variability in a lot of this visual system work. So you can't really tell about this stuff so much in when you look at brains, because you don't go to function too quickly. That's why I spend a lot of time in retina, because you're talking about what the cortex does. Well, who the hell, it's really abstract, but when you're talking about acuity or a number of rods, you're actually meeting something directly functional. So when we're looking at foveas, we looked at six different New World monkeys, and we're looking at the distribution of cells in around the fovea. And I'd say like one animal in six has a crappy fovea. Okay, so and you just don't see that stuff. I mean, we're in the regular literature. So, so maybe crappy by crappy fovea, I mean not so spatially delimited, not so packed in with cells. And maybe those are the animals that are, come the, the blanketing of the sun or something, are the ones that would be better adapted to the nocturnal site. So if you do that kind of individual variation stuff, I'd say in domains in which you think that there should be some reason for it, okay. So I started thinking about this because of this sort of imperfect visual systems.
It would allow such a species to explore the boundaries of its niche, right? It
could
if it say like, okay, we throw out a few exemplars that are a bit off, if you want, but they can explore now the boundaries of where we normally operate as a species.
Yeah.
Would you see that those in those terms, that this is
an
evolutionary mechanism?
And that's the beauty of the motivational stuff too.
Knew you would say that.
Yeah. So, like for example, the Jim Goodson, the guy who's done a lot of stuff with birds, looking at, he's interested in that sort of range about how many birds you associate with, from zero to several million. So what sets that up? So he's looking, and all those things tend to be arranged in sort of a push-pull kind of way, where too many animals, for example, will make you kind of nervous and anxious and hop around a whole lot, whereas being the right amount, you're okay, you're safe, you don't do anything. Well, suppose, that, it's just so easy to see changes in little parameters like that. Maybe here's the animal that just does not feel good in this big group. Where do they go? Do they go to the edge? Are they also nocturnal? You know what I mean? It's kind of,
right.
Yeah. So that kind of stuff makes speciation from a generic nervous system much easier to account for, I think.
Right. And also in the literature, quite some emphasis has been placed on the role of regulatory genes or host mm-hmm. genes in then executing mm-hmm. these developmental programs. So when you mm-hmm. talk about, in your data, when you mm-hmm. see these very tightly controlled developmental pathways, mm-hmm. do you also see that it's being controlled by these kinds of master genes? Or are you also mm-hmm. including other kinds of controlling mechanisms for that?
I really can't answer that, but and I hope the real geneticists here will correct me if I'm wrong, but as people begin to understand the body organizing genes and Hox genes, it's my understanding that those are defended to the death, mm-hmm. you know, to the molecule. And so I assume that's going to be the case for the sort of segmental organization of the nervous system to a degree as well. But I sort of just don't understand what I would look for in the second half of your question.
Well, but I mean, like you emphasized there, motivational coupling, embodiment.
Yeah.
These might be actually alternative regulatory mechanisms then as well, mm-hmm. because they impose new kinds of constraints.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, the one thing that Richard Dawkins said that really, really annoys me is that, are you familiar, I read Selfish Gene and the reason why genes are the only source of information, which is bullshit. Okay, so they just, the argument is that we have to give a sort of modern synthesis account of everything in terms of genes, because genes are the only sort of regulating source of information. Well, the sun comes up, the sun comes down, goes down. You know, I mean, there's all sorts of information that's regular, expectable, and can be used to organize nervous systems that is just sitting out there to be taken. It isn't the case that all information of a replicable nature is in the genome. And that's what's been missing before this kind of evo-devo change.
Right, yeah. Exactly.
I'll ask.
Okay. I think we're probably ready for coffee, I think. Yeah. So thanks very much again. So, what, 20-minute break?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah.